We begin today's service by singing hymn number 655, Son of God, Eternal Savior.
Welcome to worship on our 18th Sunday after Pentecost. Our preacher today is Pastor Lily Brondike. I, Eric Bessonen, will be your assisting minister. Worship musicians are John and Kim Beck. Livestream tech is Kyra Beck. Usher is Rodney Spence. Altar Guild is Norma Hopkins and Jackie and Julia Horath. Our radio broadcast and altar flowers are to the glory of God and in loving memory of our granddaughter, Laura Hevela, by Roy and Shirley, and by Laura's parents, Neil and Betty Hevela.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. And welcome to worship on this kind of gloomy Sunday morning. It's a joy to be together inside and join our voices in praise of God. A special welcome to everybody who is worshiping over our Facebook live stream and to those who are listening over our radio broadcast. It is a delight to be the body of Christ together through time and space. A couple quick announcements before we begin worship today. They just might help you through worship. One, if you are looking to connect with our congregation or you need to update your contact information or you would just like to fill out the newest feature of our pews, you can grab a Connect card. We would love to hear from you, to know what's up, to know if you've moved, to know if you're new to Bethany, and we need your contact information so we can properly welcome you. We would love to get to know you, so please fill out a Connect card. You can pass these Connect cards in with the offering plate while we are collecting offering later in the service. All you need for worship is yourself, your bulletin, which you were handed on your way in, and this book that you'll find in your pews. In our bulletin, you'll notice there's different ways of numbering things. You'll see our hymns are numbered with big numbers, and those are sort of in the main section. But in your bulletin, if you see something referred to as page, number, fill in the blank, you're gonna flip in the front part of your hymnal. And so if you're dying to know more about what we're doing and why we're doing it, that is a great section to follow along worship with. So I invite you to use these books as you are called to. They are filled with good worship information and music notation if you're a music reader. We gather on Sundays knowing that we have come from all sorts of weeks, busy weeks, boring weeks. Maybe you've had the worst week of your life. Maybe you've had the best week of your life, but we trust that the Holy Spirit has gathered us, the body of Christ, here today to worship and praise God. I invite you as we begin to take a deep breath in and to let it out. And when you are ready, I invite you to rise as we begin worship this morning. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin and come to God for healing. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have honored you with our lips, but have harmed our neighbors with our tongues. The cravings at war within us cause conflicts and disputes. In our desire to be first, we make distinctions among ourselves. We place the needs of the poor and the suffering last. In your great mercy, forgive us our sins. Draw near to us with grace in time of need, and turn us to follow in the way of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God promises to forgive our iniquity and to remember our sin no more. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of all eternal healing, your sins are forgiven. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. And praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. This is the feast.
You draw us to yourself and welcome us as beloved children. Help us to lay aside all envy and selfish ambition, that we may walk in your ways of wisdom and understanding as servants of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from Jeremiah. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I knew. Then you showed me their evil deeds. But I was like a gentle lamb led to slaughter, and I did not know it was against me. And they devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be remembered. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them. For to you I have committed my cause. The word of the Lord.
This morning, we sing responsively from Psalm 54.
Our second reading is from James. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. The word of the Lord. Please stand for the gospel acclamation.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of
Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus and the disciples went on and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Who were you before you were told who to be? Before you were told to like these things, but not those things. Before you were told for the first time that it was better if you took up less space than more space. Or maybe you were told that it would be better for you to take up more space. Before you were told you didn't talk right or look right or eat right or learn right, who were you before you were told that your dreams were silly and your ambitions were a fool's? Before you were told you are too old for play and imagination, before you were told you were too quiet or too loud, before life told you to be more like someone else or something else, who were you before you were told who to be? There are signs up in all sorts of places that say, "All are welcome." Our very own sign out front has said this. Our website says this in multiple places. And I have said that same line standing here in this very sanctuary. All are welcome. It embodies Jesus' message so well, a simple phrase constructed to convey love and security and joy at the presence of all people. All are welcome, meaning that you are welcome, so come on in and join us. But who were you before who you were told who to be? And is that you welcome? When I say all are welcome, I mean it. But maybe, if you think differently than me, it would be really hard to be together, and so maybe it would just be best if you found somewhere else to be welcomed. Yes, all are welcome, but maybe if you're going to vote differently than me, we should just not talk to each other. I mean, you're still welcome, but let's just pretend like we are not in the same space. Yes, all are welcome, but if you don't speak the same language as me, well, that's just very impractical. That's not going to work. Yes, all are welcome, but I was here first, so the rules are different. Yes, all are welcome, but only if you let me teach you how to become more like me. Yes, all are welcome, and I'm even glad you're here. But you're in my pew. When I say all are welcome, I mean it, or at least I really want to mean it. All are welcome, but if you, what? What holds us back? In today's gospel reading, the scene begins with Jesus and his friends traveling on the way. Jesus is teaching his disciples about God's plan. Jesus is going to suffer. Jesus is going to be killed by human hands. It's not really your classic road trip conversation. But we learn that on the way, Jesus' disciples begin to argue. Along the way, the disciples had begun to bicker about who was the greatest. Who, perhaps because of their proximity to Jesus, who is the Messiah after all, is the best? Who does Jesus like the best? Who is the greatest? At this point in the gospel, Jesus has taught them multiple times about his upcoming suffering. He had healed the sick and spent time with the suffering. He had performed miracles. Jesus had begun his ministry. And amid it all, the disciples are arguing about who among them is the greatest. And here's the thing. I get it. And I'm guessing you do too. Loud voices, arguing, vying for power through greatness in argument. I mean, it doesn't sound all that unfamiliar. And maybe it doesn't just happen in our gospel story this morning. It is easy to say, yes, we love kindness and gentleness, and yet we applaud grit and grind, power and might. We point to Jesus' way of humility and solidarity with the suffering. We lift up the cross as our own path to following Christ in this world. We point to God's life-saving love and grace, and yet we seek leaders in our midst who are strong and powerful, mighty and loud, who are gruff and assertive, who mean what they say and take what they want. We tell people that to have a voice at the table, you better earn your place at the table. That you have to yell to be heard, that you have to be startling and attention-seeking to have a voice, or it doesn't matter, or you don't matter. And then we tell people that they're too shrill at their place at the table. We speak over the meek. We push aside those deemed less important. We tell people they need to be someone else. They need to be something else before they're welcome to the meeting, the leadership, the dinner, the table, or the club. Have you ever felt unwelcome in a space? Like your voice was less important because of who you are, how long you were there, who your family is, or how you spoke? When have you felt unwelcome? There's this subliminal message in our world that you need to earn your place at the table in this world. You need to pull yourself up and prove yourself worthy, that you will indeed be judged by what you do, not who you are. And perhaps there are valuable lessons to be learned in this. And I wonder if that day in Capernaum, the disciples had similar questions rolling through their head. It was a world where who you knew mattered, and they knew Jesus, and he was getting to be quite known and perhaps a little infamous in the right circles. Then Jesus, what does he do amidst the loud, bickering voices? He grabs a child and pulls the child to him and says, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." Jesus pulls a child and places that child among them right in their midst. They cannot ignore this child. And up until that moment, they probably hadn't noticed that child's presence at all. You see, children were generally viewed as property or liabilities. They were another mouth to feed without being able to help feed those mouths. They were at best second-class citizens, but most likely they weren't even that. Children were the forgotten, underfoot people of the world. Yet, Jesus takes one of these, who may not even be considered human at the time, and places it among the bickering disciples, places this child in the midst of the argument of who is the greatest, and says, "Whoever welcomes one such as these, whoever welcomes the vulnerable, whoever welcomes the other, whoever welcomes the forgotten and disenfranchised of the world, whoever welcomes one such as these, forgotten and hated and scorned, welcomes Jesus into their midst." And so we come back to the question, who were you before you were told who you were supposed to be? I think this question is important when we consider today's text. Society has roles that must be filled, yes. Society has social systems, yes. But God? God created you. You are a beloved and claimed child of God, and you were that before the world told you who you were supposed to be. You were lovingly knit together in your mother's womb. You were equipped with the gifts of the Spirit to be loved and to love in this world. God, the creator of the whole cosmos, delights in who you are. And that's all of you. And maybe there are parts of yourselves you have had to forget or leave behind in order to make it in this world. Perhaps there are dreams and ambitions that have to be left unrealized because of circumstance and reality. But Jesus places this child in the center of our midst. Jesus places the forgotten and the most vulnerable in the center of our midst, and he asks us to look and to see who we really are before the world tells us who we ought to be. And Jesus points and says, "I choose you," points and says, "This is my path." It's as if Jesus is looking at each of us and saying, you who are beautifully and wonderfully made, do you know God wants to know you? Do you know that God wants and craves and desires a relationship with you? All of who you are is welcome at God's table. All of you is delighted in at God's feast. All are welcome is indeed Jesus's message, and he makes it our aspirational goal. And maybe that's why so many churches use "all are welcome." It's probably not true that we have all done enough work to be equipped and prepared to welcome all people into our midst. Maybe "all are welcome" is not a statement, but an aspirational goal set by Jesus himself. This work welcomes us to be who we are for the sake of the other. When we claim who we are, beloved children of God, brought together by the Holy Spirit into the body of Christ, we are equipped and set out into the world to love with God's whole heart. And we give others permission to do the same. So when the world says, "You are not welcome at this table, there is no room for you at this feast," God's church is standing there with arms outstretched. When hateful and fear-mongering and dishonest rhetoric hit national news of immigrant population, we are the church saying, "No, Jesus loves you and so do I." Beloved child of God, God has claimed all of you for life eternal, for God's reign, and God has done the same for all of creation. For the least of these, for the immigrant, for the prisoner, for all the politicians, for all the children. Through Jesus, God has reconciled the person sitting forgotten in a nursing home, the families fleeing from war zones in Gaza, the orphans finding their own way through refugee camps, the high school senior celebrating a bittersweet last homecoming, and the cancer patient beginning chemo next week. Jesus makes our calling as church clear. Yes, you are a beloved child of God, and so are they. He sets the vulnerable and forgotten in our midst. He calls us to be among the forgotten peoples of the world and to welcome them into a grace and love that surpasses our understanding. You are a beloved child of God, but so are they, whoever they may be. All are welcome at God's table. A place has been set for all at God's feast. All are welcome. This is what Jesus says. All are welcome. That is the work we are called to do. Amen. Join our voices confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Drawn together in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray with confidence for the church, God's good creation, and all who are in need. Loving God, you welcome all at your table of grace. Instill in your church a spirit of humility and curiosity that we embrace all who seek you. We pray especially for the ministries of hospitality and faith formation. Hear us, O God. Creating God, you shape the world so there is more than enough for all. Curb our habits of overuse and guide us toward more sustainable sources of energy, food, and water. Hear us, O God. Gracious God, your peace brings justice and solidarity. Encourage peace among the peoples, tribes, nations. Heal divisions in our country and local communities, that together we might cooperate for the good of all. Hear us, O God. Faithful God, you draw near to you all who are in need. Bring healing and wholeness to all who suffer, especially Lynn Liebel, Bert Zenker, Jim Lancor, Bob Pulowski, Lloyd Jensen, Kristen Farrell, Christopher Lund, Rosemary Hendrickson, Eileen Servant, Dave Clissell, Nancy Pearson, and those who we name before you now, either aloud or in this moment of silence. Transform economic, political, and social systems that oppress vulnerable people, especially systems of structural racism and generational poverty. Hear us, O God. Transforming God, you accompany all through changes and transitions. Help us to see where you are calling this community to new ways of living the gospel promise. Assure us that even as change brings loss, it also brings hope and life. Hear us, O God. Merciful God, you embrace us on our final pilgrimage from this life. Accompany all who have died, console those who mourn, and at the last, show us the way to eternal life in you. Hear us, O God. We entrust these and all our prayers to you, Holy God, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always. Please share signs of that peace with one another.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. And the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Here at Bethany Lutheran, we believe that Jesus has set a place for you at this, the Lord's table. Wherever you may be on your spiritual journey, you are most welcome to receive communion here. If you would not like to receive the elements, you may come up and request a blessing. Our ushers will guide you forward down the center aisle, where you may choose to stand or kneel at our communion rail. If this is not accessible to you, just let us know and we will bring communion to you. In the center of these trays is a lighter colored liquid that is a non-alcoholic apple juice, and we have gluten-free wafers available as well. Just let me know if you would like one of those. Jesus welcomes you to this table. Come, here is your God. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, you have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. At this time, I would like to invite any kids worshiping with us to come on forward. Oh, I am so glad you are all here. Welcome, come on up, come on up. I'm gonna have you guys sit up here. Oh, welcome, welcome, welcome. Were all of you in Sunday school today? Many of you were in Sunday school today. How was Sunday school? Was it super fun? Yeah, what was your favorite part? It was all of it.
Yeah.
Oh, Julia, do you have one thing? Eating the grapes? Oh, we didn't have grapes. Oh, Sunday school sounds like so much fun. I'm so glad you guys are having fun with Miss Jackie. I would like to, right here, Easton. I have a question. What is your favorite thing about yourself? What is your favorite thing about yourself? Yes. Yes. Oh, that's wonderful. Yes, Cam. Oh, can we jump to our next friend? Thank you, Easton. Your cat? Oh, you can talk. I love talking myself. I know a lot of you love talking too. Oh, yeah, I got a sticker. What else? What is your favorite thing about yourself? What is your favorite thing about yourself? Yes. Your hair, yes, that's a wonderful thing about you. Yes. Yes, your body, that is a wonderful thing. Our bodies do so much for us. That's incredible. Oh, that's beautiful. Yes, you guys have an incredible sense of fashion. Yes. I have seen all of you sitting up here be very kind. That's one of my favorite things. You're very nice to one another. You play with one another. Now, even if you didn't share it, I bet you have something that you love about yourself. Is that true? Do you have something that you love about your friends and family too? Yeah, oh, what are those sorts of things? Just so nice. Let's jump to. Yeah, just one. She's pretty nice. Let's jump to our other friend. Oh, yes. Fishing and hunting with our family. That's fun. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, lots of fun. What about you, Julia? How loving they are. Yes, that's a great one. We're gonna take one more. Traveling with your family. Yes, there are so many lovely things about us, and there are so many lovely things about the people that God puts in our life, and that's something we celebrate and give thanks for, right? Aren't we thankful for all the lovely things that God creates in us and all the lovely things God creates in people around us? Do you think we should say a prayer of thanks to God? Yeah, awesome. Let's say a prayer. And with this prayer, we are going to pray that we never forget the things we love about ourselves and the things we love about the people around us. So stand up. Praying is a pretty big deal here. All right, Easton, can I have you stand up? We got to stretch nice and big. Otherwise, we're going to pull a prayer muscle. All right, reach them up high. Touch your toes. All right, spin your arms. Ooh. All right, let's do some arm circles. Yeah, this is going to be a big prayer. I can just feel it. All right, stretch your arms out wide. Wrap your friend Jesus into a hug, and everyone is invited to repeat after me. All right, is everyone? to hear and repeat after me. You have to be quiet. All right. Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for me. Thank you for my friends. Thank you for my family. And all the wonderful gifts you give to us. Beat on the floor. Help me always remember that I am a beloved child of God. Amen. All right, you all can head back to your seats. Thank you so much. Oh, please do not forget your sparkly bow. Oh, no. Would you like your bow back? Yeah, I know it's not my color. There you go. I know, it looks better on her. All right, I just have a few announcements as we go on our way today. One of them being kind of immediate. We have a little program change for our first adult forum today. What is an adult forum, you ask? Oh, wonderful question. So our adult forum time is going to be time that we dedicate after our worship service to fellowship and learning for the sake of faith formation. And so today after worship, there are coffee and donuts in the fellowship hall. You are welcome to join down there for fellowship. And in a few minutes, we are going to begin our first program, which is not a speaker from Tri-County Safe Harbor. They had some personal emergencies to tend to, so our prayers go with them. But instead, you will get to hear me talk more. And I am going to be sharing about my year in the ELCA Church's Young Adults in Global Mission Program. I served in Senegal as a young adult missionary for a year after I graduated from college, and I'm going to be sharing about that year. And I have some show and tell items, I think. Thumbs up from transport in the back. And so please come down, coffee, fellowship, learning about a new place in the world in a ministry of our church. Next week, we will be hearing from our youth who went to New Orleans with the youth gathering this summer. Next week also, be sure to be in worship. We are having a worship service led by me, but more importantly, by some of our young people here in the congregation. Our middle school and high school students are helping us lead worship next week. This Thursday, a representative from Lutheran World Relief, who we ship our quilts through, who are wonderful quilters, make so many gifts to go out and embrace people in God's love and warmth and security. There is a presentation this Thursday at 1 p.m. at First Lutheran Church in Gladstone from a representative from Lutheran World Relief talking about what those quilts go out into the world to do. So if you are free, please head over to Gladstone. We have some dates for our next new member class. I know some of you are waiting, so we finally got those on the book. So October 16th, with a follow-up class on November 6th, if you or someone you know is interested in knowing what it means and what life here at Bethany Lutheran is like and what it means to be a member, these are the classes for you. If you're seeking membership, we hope to set you up with mentors and mentor families to kind of talk to you about their time at Bethany and walk you through what it is to be a part of our church. So I'll see you in a bit downstairs, but as you go on your way, I hope you remember that today we have heard the word of God proclaimed through word and scripture. We have sung God's praises. We have received God's grace in the meal. And now we go out to share a bit of that love and welcome with all we encounter. I invite you to rise and to receive this blessing. God Almighty, God most merciful, bless you, keep you, and give you peace.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to be seen.
Jesus.